Good morning, Bridge. Happy Sunday. If you are out in the gathering room, if you want to come on in, we've got seats, plenty of seats right here up front. You can hang out with the band. I am so excited to be here this morning. I was thinking, so this week was wild and crazy. All the weeks are wild and crazy, it feels like. But this week especially had some special items that made it kind of kooky for us. And I was driving in this morning, and it was snowing a little bit, and all the trees were covered. And I was just so thankful for the rest that is a Sunday. I'm so thankful that God gave us Sundays, that we can come and be together as a church family and just enjoy his presence and worship and be fed and just encourage each other and be here with each other. So I'm really thankful to be here with you guys today. You guys are giving me a lot of peace after a very busy week, and I'm excited to worship. We've got a great set of Christmas songs. So if you'll stand with us this morning, but first, friendly reminder, you can stand, it's okay. It is Sunday. Today is Sunday the 18th. A week from today is Christmas Day. We will not have church next week Sunday. So don't show up at the building. You will be locked out. You'll be out in the snow. You can sing a few Christmas carols in the parking lot if you choose. Next week, Saturday, is Christmas Eve. We will be doing a Christmas Eve service at 6 p.m. at our Dalton campus. So we're all going to gather together and be up at Dalton campus at 6 p.m. And we do have invitation cards out at the welcome desk. So if you've got some people in your life that are, you know, not sure where they're landing for church, or maybe don't have a church family and you want to invite them with you to come, would absolutely encourage you to grab a welcome card or a invitation card out at the welcome desk and get those out to your people. So, all right, let's sing together. His name now and always. Amen. I love Christmas. If you don't know me well, I get a little excited about Christmas. And I've always loved since I was little the idea that the Christmas songs that we sing as a church, as a body, are the same Christmas songs that generations of Christians have sung. I love Gloria in Excelsis Deo. Like, that is some old language that I don't speak, right? But God has given us the gift of generational faith and the gift of the history of the church. And some of these songs have some weird words, and we're like, I don't really know what that means. And this one is one of them. We're singing the First Noel next. And there's a line in there that has the word not in it. So it feels a little funny coming out of our mouths. But they are the foundations of a lot of the hymns and praise songs that we sing now. So I love that at Christmas time we can pull out some of the old songs. They get a little redone by a few of our favorite artists, but this is one of my favorites, and I'm excited to sing it this morning with you guys.
Thank you.
out. The King is born, the King is born, the King is born. The King is born, the King is born, the King is born. Amen. So as our littles go ahead and head off to their class, I'm actually going to invite you to go ahead and take a seat. Our next song is a little bit special, and we have a video for you. So the band is going to play. The video has lyrics. I would invite you to just sit and listen, read those lyrics, reflect on those lyrics, and think about the story of how Jesus came to be here with us, Emmanuel with us, and how everything changed because God sent his son to be here with us.
On a broken road, she is far from sleep, she is far from home. For a baby's cries tear the still of night, and she wonders why. The future was bright and clear, planned for wedding day. Her daddy would hold back tears, giving her hand away. Now all her hope and fear in a cradle lay, 'cause a baby came and everything changed. Could not let him go, and she now knows why. The future was bright and clear, with hope and a promise made. The light of the world was near, choirs of angels sang. Heaven's exalted King, a baby came and everything changed. When our dreams grow dim and our hearts grow cold, he is never far from our broken soul.
Gloria, our God is with us. Gloria, he has come to save. Mercy and love now forever. Came
Well, good morning. As we continue our series on rediscovering the good news of Christmas, I invite you to turn to the second chapter of Luke's Gospel, where we will be focusing on a small but significant part of the angelic message to the shepherds about the birth of Jesus the Messiah. Before we go back to the first century and reflect on ways the incarnation can impact us today, think with me about a new creative technology that was just beginning to emerge when I was in elementary school in the 60s. It's called comic books. It was through these 10-cent marvels, no pun intended, that I began to learn about colorful individuals such as Alfred E. Newman and his Crazy Magazine. Or how about the pre-hippie hipster named Archie? I also learned when I was a kid about larger-than-life superheroes like the Caped Crusader, Batman, and his sidekick, Robin. The amazing Amazon, Wonder Woman. The lime green mutant, the Incredible Hulk. Looking back, I'd like to tell you that I think my favorite was Superman. I mean, what's not to like about a being who is faster than a speeding bullet, more powerful than a locomotive, and able to leap tall buildings with a single bound? Especially when said being also possesses X-ray, heat, telescopic, and microscopic vision. Or he had superhuman strength. Superman was also invulnerable and had the capacity to fly at will. There was, though, one problem with Superman. And no, I'm not referring to his alter ego, Clark Kent's obsessive crush on the pretty reporter, Lois Lane. I'm talking about his Achilles heel, which was his one vulnerability that his arch enemies would seek to exploit over and over and over again. It was the mythical substance called kryptonite. Kryptonite adversely affected the Man of Steel in a variety of ways. Whether white, green, yellow, blue, or perhaps the worst kryptonite of all, gold, depending on the number and length of exposures, Superman could be plagued with mental confusion, subject to human pain and suffering, find his powers diminished, and even potentially stripped away forever. That's how kryptonite affected Superman. Do you know that we're also subject to the negative effects of kryptonite? I'm obviously not talking about real kryptonite, not in a literal sense, but our figurative kryptonite comes in the form of things that tend to invade our sense of well-being and peace, potentially leaving us in a state of anxiety and anxiousness. We often refer to these things as joy killers. Joy killers. 2 weeks ago, we began our December Advent series, Rediscover Christmas, by looking at ways to find hope in the midst of our uncertainties. Last week, we examined ways to find peace in the midst of our struggles. And this morning, in the time we have remaining, we're going to consider ways to find joy in the midst of our discouragements. Perhaps you're among those whose lives, though far from perfect, are in a pretty good place. The job's going well, or you're enjoying retirement. Inflation hasn't horribly impacted your finances yet. You feel reasonably healthy. You enjoy far more positivity than drama in your relationships. And your soul is in a peaceful place before God. At the same time, I suspect that many here today find their lives described in much more negative terms. Things like toxic work environments, broken relationships, medical diagnoses with uncertain futures, struggles week by week to afford even the basic things of life, and constant guilt, and the list goes on and on and on. I'm convinced, without sounding cliched, that more than ever before, joy is an important tool to help us offset the discouragements of this world, those that are hitting some of us now, or those that will assuredly hit the rest of us down the road. With this in mind, for the next few minutes, I want to focus on three points: the definition of joy, the need for joy, and the results from joy. So before we look at Luke 2, let's first establish the definition of joy. Exactly what do we mean when we throw out this term? Well, throughout the Bible, joy is a fairly general word understood in part by the meaning of the word itself along with the various contexts in which it's seen. Some ways that joy is defined in Scripture include the following: glad enthusiasm and delight, jubilance, pleasure and happiness, a sense of inner contentment and satisfaction. Joy is a willfully positive internal response to adverse external circumstances. Joy is a supernatural undergirding produced in our hearts as a gift from the Holy Spirit, often noted especially during hardship. Joy is the same as contentment, cheerfulness, gladness, excitement, and the idea of possessing a cheerful disposition, a cheerful attitude. In addition to its definition, here are some ways that joy is displayed throughout the pages of Scripture. In the Old Testament, it was expressed during Sabbath worship and on the various Jewish holidays with things like singing, dancing, shouting, making music with different instruments, clapping, and there's even a record of foot stomping. Often the expressions of joy included sacrifice offerings and feasting as God was honored by his people during times of triumph and abundance, such as military victories, celebrating an abundant harvest, and times of personal reflection. In many of the Psalms, joy was communicated often as a counterpart to lamenting over sad conditions. And in one of Isaiah's many messianic prophecies, the birth of Christ would magnify the joy of God's chosen people. In the New Testament, joy is often a byproduct of reflecting on the believer's redemption, like boasting or glorying in the cross and the empty tomb as a remedy for sin and death. In Luke chapter 15, we're told that there is joy in the presence of the angels when an unsaved sinner turns to the Lord in repentance and faith. And the early Christians were shown to manifest joy when welcoming fellow believers into their gatherings. The Apostle Paul testified to having joy despite his imprisonment and pending execution. And James asserts that choosing joy in the midst of trials would be a help to our Christian discipleship and maturity. In both the Old and New Testaments, God's people exhibited joy in human events such as weddings and births, and it was part of a welcoming attitude within the faith community during times when God's word was read and taught. That's when joy was expressed. To help us further understand some aspects of joy, here are a few quotes that I found that I thought you might appreciate. In the New International Encyclopedia of Biblical Words, we're told, joy is not so much a private emotion as it is the enthusiastic response of a feasting company or worshiping community to God's tangible and intangible blessings. Mounce's expository dictionary says this: the joy of the Lord transcends all earthly circumstances, and Christian joy is actually proven through hardship. And I like what pastor and author Rick Warren says about joy. It is the settled assurance that God is in control of all the details of my life, the quiet confidence that ultimately everything is going to be all right, and the determined choice to praise God in every situation. Hopefully that quick background gives you a sense of the definition of joy. So let's move to our second point, the need for joy. And this raises a very good question. What are some of the reasons why joy is a valuable commodity? I'd like to begin addressing that by having us now look at Luke chapter 2. I'm going to read starting in verse 8. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning the child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. I'd like to especially have us keep in our mind the powerful statement from verse 10, good news of great joy, which shall be for all the people. So, why did first century Israelites need joy? Let's go back 2,000 years and just plant ourselves here for a minute. Why did they need joy? For the average Jewish person, things were far from ideal. Religiously and spiritually, despite the fact that God had still had a small but faithful remnant, much of Judaism lacked the vibrant faith that they once had, the faith of their forefathers. There had been no word from the Lord in some 400 years. No prophecies, no miracles, no manifest presence of God. It was just deafening silence for the Jews. Also, no Messiah was evident who could liberate them and lead them back to the place that they once had, a prominent nation, victors over everything. Spiritually, their faith was corrupted. The religious leaders were fragmented as the Sadducees, Pharisees, scribes, and other groups vied for market share. They vied for power, for the allegiance of the people. Outwardly, there were very little distinctions between those who were Yahweh's people and the average Roman counterpart in terms of how they looked, how they acted, and what they believed. Religiously and spiritually, they were watered down. How about politically? This once proud but now shamed nation had been geographically dispersed and militarily weakened. Now they were required to live under the thumb of their Roman oppressors, the figurehead of which was the wicked, harsh, despised non-Jew, Herod the Great, not the promised descendant of King David. For first century Jews, joy was clearly needed. How about today? Why do people today need joy? I would like to suggest several reasons for us too. Some of the modern joy killers include guilt and shame. Whether it's felt or whether it's squelched through various types of self-medication, the fact is that apart from Jesus Christ, humankind is under God's wrath and every being is apart from grace, and it's an awful, awful place to be. Listen to how the Apostle Paul described those who are apart from salvation in his letter to the Ephesian believers. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Just let that statement percolate. No hope without God in the world. Guilt and shame. People also need joy because of the loss of national identity or sovereignty. And in this regard, I think about right now the millions of people in war-torn countries or formerly from war-torn countries, such as Ukraine and Afghanistan and other places, where rampant human rights abuses and widespread persecution is the norm. Like the first century Israelites, whose multi-generational tribal lands were under the oppressive Roman rule, imagine finding yourself today as a refugee, literally or figuratively, in a place that would never, ever feel like home. I can't imagine that. I get email communications from some friends who serve in Kosovo, and they sent out a note yesterday, which I want to just give you an excerpt, and they are requesting prayer because they said, tensions are rising. Political tensions are currently at a high between Kosovo and Serbia. Serbia is an ally of Russia, and it's suspected that Russia is encouraging Serbia to stir up trouble in our region to draw attention away from what is happening in Ukraine. This is very close to home, as it is all happening on the north side of our city. What if that were Bridge? What if this were a few miles away? How would we feel? A quick aside, a few people have recently raised very good questions about how well we're doing financially and if there's any way that we can use maybe some of the overage because we overgive on the budget side, underspend on the income side, and we have a surplus. And the finance team has tried to keep a healthy amount in our checking account balance in case of emergencies. Remember how many of you were here a few years ago when we had the PVC pipes underneath the long hallway that just basically disintegrated, and $40,000-ish later, it's all better. That was crazy. But they try to keep a healthy amount in the account for things like that, or if we were to have a downturn for a couple months. But the good news is the finance team has allocated some funds from the overage, which we're planning to make available to some Ukrainian refugees. We have several direct ties from our church, including the IBAM people and Scott and Lisa Carter, who serve in that region when they travel back and forth. So, and Lisa is from Ukraine. She was born and raised there. So we're planning to use some of that, and we're planning to have, in addition to some of the funds from the overage, a special information and giving emphasis that will happen in January. So stay tuned for more details, as they say, but I think that will be a great use of some of our overage funds, because there are brothers and sisters in Christ who are meeting in church buildings probably similar to ours, where in Ukraine they're still being bombed and terrorized, and we just can't imagine that. So, why do people need joy today? Guilt and shame, loss of national identity or sovereignty. I thought about a third one. Adverse circumstances now, coupled with the fear of what might happen in the future. Adverse circumstances now, coupled with fear of what might happen in the future. If you're someone who genuinely cares for people, even in our congregation, you don't have to look very long or very far to see that we have people who are walking through pretty deep waters right now. I thought again this week of the 14-year-old boy, Caden Boyer, part of our Dalton campus. 14, and he's fighting a very serious form of cancer. I appreciate that a few weeks ago, Gus and Debbie Barquette were very transparent with us, and they said, please pray earnestly as she undergoes treatment for sarcoma, which is also a very serious form of cancer. And a few weeks ago, if you were here for communion or watch it online, you know that I interviewed an Albanian pastor named Quitim. Quitim and his wife, Lauren, and their four kids are here for an extended period of time because he's being treated with some potentially serious heart issues. And they're working with him. He's living in Muskegon temporarily, Norton Shores area, with some family. But we're also trying to pray this brother through these cardiac issues to be treated and then be able to go back to his country. I can't imagine what it's like, and there are doubtless others in both of our campuses or extended family outside of those circles who are walking through really deep medical hardships right now, and we need to be cognizant of those and support these brothers and sisters and pray for them and encourage them. I thought about a number of my friends who are in the midst of other trials. There are people at Bridge who struggle tremendously paycheck to paycheck, and it seems like they cannot get ahead financially. There are people here at Bridge who are struggling in tremendous ways in relationships, alienation from other family members, longtime friendships that have basically vaporized. I think of a number of marriages. It seemed like the devil has his sights on marriage and family today, and boy, there's just a number of marriages within our midst who are struggling, and we just need to prayerfully support and encourage these people because joy is not evident in those situations. I think of another group of people, my generation, us boomers, raised a bunch of millennials, and you know, for a lot of us, we struggle with our kids walking away from their faith right out of high school or soon after or as they get into their careers. And many times that's against the backdrop of having been Christian educated and spent time for 12, 13, 14 of their formative years in a good church. And they walk away, and sometimes the term is deconstructionism, right? Sometimes their faith is deconstructed because they struggle with a lot of the blatant hypocrisy that they might have seen from their parents or peers. And I think, guilty as charged, who among us walks in a perfect manner? But sometimes they struggle with pretty blatant hypocrisy. Sometimes they struggle with intellectual issues that are real, reconciling the good and loving side of God with the injustices that happen today. And they want to wrestle deeply with all the things that are unjust in our culture, and yet did they sometimes overreact? I think so, but I don't walk where they walk. I know that for my peers, this is a big struggle. And sometimes, frankly, I think that, and my generation does it too, all generations do it, we think that we're owed happiness, right? God is our lucky rabbit's foot, God is our genie in a lamp, and if you do X, Y, and Z, God owes you A, B, and C, and A plus B doesn't always equal C in that regard. There are times where I sow very, very good things, and I get very, very mediocre, sometimes even bad and hard results. But I think they've bought into the lie of culture that you can have it all, and at the end of the day, God wants us to be happy. Again, without sounding cliche, it's better to be holy than happy. And if you are holy, then I would suggest to you that much of the time you are happy and fulfilled, that you have a sense of fulfillment, that makarios, that blessing. But the idea that friends experienced their kids walking away and deconstructing their faith, that's a very hard thing for every parent. You raise your child, you protect them, you care for them, and then they do a 180. Children and teens who are here, can I just say, keep your nose in the book? Because when you walk out there, there are a ton of incredibly convincing voices that just want to just say to you, hey, we have the answer over here. And it's fake, and it's false, and it doesn't last. End of little mini sermon. Another type of adverse circumstances are people who've experienced unchecked judgmentalism imposed by family, friends, sometimes churches. I, for whatever reason, I tend to be a magnet for people, and I get in these conversations fairly often with people who've been horribly abused by churches that have power and have used it wrongly. Can I say, without being trite, if you ever see me abusing my position, will you pull me aside? Take me to Starbucks, but pull me aside and have a conversation with me. I and our team want to lead well, and we do that best by walking among you and washing your feet. And if we don't do that well, and there's some areas where we can do better, please point that out, because the last thing I want to be known is a church that wields power as opposed to a church that earns credibility, and they're followed because people want to be. Guilt and shame, loss of national identity or sovereignty, adverse circumstances now or in the future. Fourth, spiritual and emotional struggles. And here I'm talking about a depression that won't lift, habits that are bad that will not ease up, a lack of vibrance in your Christian walk. Maybe even you lack assurance as to whether or not you are a child of God, and you struggle immensely with that. I want to say spiritual and emotional struggles are real, and we need to combat that with joy. And then there's a fifth broad, I call it the catch-all category, unmet expectations. Life just throws curves at us sometimes, doesn't it? It rolls, and sometimes there's non-stop negativity, and there's despair, and can I say that we really need joy to be able to handle those things when, not if, but when they come at us? So with those and lots of other reasons, I believe that the first century Jews needed joy. We need joy today. We need the type of joy that God provides in order to help us navigate the ups and downs of life. And really that leads to my final point, the results of joy, or the results from joy. Back to verse 10 in the Luke passage, three phrases that I want to just highlight for a minute. Good news. Good news. We need good news today. This is the word you're aware that we translate often gospel. It's a term used more by Luke than any other New Testament writer. And then the idea of great joy. It's the Greek word chara. It's readily associated with salvation through Jesus Christ. So the good news, the gospel, has great joy, this idea that salvation is offered. I love how Peter put it in his epistle, 1 Peter 1, verses 8 and 9. Though now you do not see him, you believe in him, Christ, and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. It's amazing. It's good news, which offsets the bad news. It's something that brings great joy. And the text says it's for all the people. You've heard Christmas messages before, and you know that it's just an amazing thing that the angel came to the shepherds first, who were lowest of the low. And it didn't just stay there. The message was given to the Israelites who were dispersed. And then the message was also offered later to the Gentiles. In verses 25 through 32, listen to what Simeon says. He prays this beautiful, beautiful, beautiful blessing. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. This is what we call a representation of the righteous remnant, the righteous Jewish remnant. And it had been revealed to him by the Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. It's beautiful. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, you are now letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation that you prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. That statement was a big, big thing. Remember Saul of Tarsus, who later became the Apostle Paul? Saul was a Pharisee of Pharisees, educated under one of the most famous rabbis of all time, Gamaliel. And he owned this idea of self-righteousness to the point of persecuting the church severely until he was converted on the road to Damascus. And one of Paul's charges was to take the gospel beyond the Jews, beyond his people, to the Gentiles. And that was no small thing, considering that the Jews had a lot of nationalistic pride and felt that they had market share on this thing called salvation, which wasn't true. And think about even Jesus' last words in Acts chapter 1, where he said, basically, you're going to go to Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria. Wait, Samaritans? Samaritans were hated. Nope, go to Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. The gospel was going to go for all the people. So as we think about the angelic message to the shepherds, which promised true and lasting salvation, this should drive down, it should anchor deep the fact that we can have joy in our souls today. I love how the Apostle Paul encouraged the Galatians with this truth. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father, so that you are no longer a slave, but a son, and if a son, an heir through God. How can God's joy help us rediscover Christmas today, this week, into the rest of the Advent season? I'm going to suggest four things. Number one, God's unmatched love in sending his Son to die in our place. That is the absolute best gift ever. Never lose the wonder of that. Number two, God's unmerited favor for all who would turn away from their sin and their own remedies and turn to him by faith. And as I often say when I'm preaching, if there has not been a definite time and place when you've acknowledged your sinfulness, you've expressed your need before God, you've cried out to his Son to be your personal Savior, and you've just said, God, I am done directing my own life. I believe by faith that you died in my place and I received the gift of salvation. I would love to layer that with more information and help you to begin that journey as I did back in December of 1975 in a church service much like this. God's unmerited favor for all who would turn from their sin to him by faith. A third way that joy can help us rediscover Christmas is God's unsurpassed grace, not just to save, but to sustain and to give hope no matter how hard life is now. When I was talking a few minutes ago and I was laying out a panorama of some of the things that some of our folks struggle with, can I say that if you are walking through deep waters right now, I want to just say you are loved. You are loved by God. You are loved by us. And I want to just say you do not walk alone. And if you are here and you're undergoing something and you feel like nobody knows, nobody cares, nobody really knows me, catch me after the service. Call me today. I will connect you. We will walk together, because no one at Bridge should ever have to walk through the valley alone, because God, through his people, provides unsurpassed grace to sustain and not just save. And fourth and finally, joy can help us rediscover Christmas by knowing that we have God's unprecedented message to share. You realize we don't have to go around trying to convince people that our religion is right. We can kindly and humbly and respectfully present the truth that compared to every other religion who's ever existed, Christianity is unique in that God doesn't win, God loses, but ultimately then God wins, if that makes sense. It's a paradox. It's an irony. In every religion, God stands with his or her power and expects to be appeased by all of the people under his authority. And if you appease it just the right way, based on the various tenets of the various religions, then somehow you will please this being and you'll make it into whatever state of glory that particular faith tradition has at the end of the rainbow. Christianity is different. Christianity says God loved the world so much that he didn't leave them in their lost estate, but he sent himself in the form of his son to die for us. As we saw in the video a few minutes ago, he did that because he loves us greatly, and that's an unprecedented message to share. That's what brings true joy. So how can we help rediscover Christmas through the joy God provides? Because of his unmatched love, his unmerited favor, his unsurpassed grace, and an unprecedented message that we can take to the world today without apology and with great humility. We're going to do one more song, but as the band starts to make their way back up here, I want to close the service with reading a prayer. It's really an adaptation of a blessing for Advent that was written by one of my favorite authors, Kate Bowler. God, we are waiting and longing for you, our everlasting joy. O come to us, be with us, make our joy complete. Blessed are we who wait for you in the desert of our longing and isolation, in the wilderness that is our present struggle. Blessed are we who have sat down to wait at the still point between desire and expectation. We have quieted our souls to listen, for your words are life to us. Blessed are we who have this settled purpose. We are collecting ourselves. We are getting ready. We are clearing away the space to receive you. For we have glimpsed something of your glory, your power, your joy, and our hope is in you. O blessed babe of Bethlehem, you came for this one loving purpose, that your joy may be in us and that it might be complete.
That song is a banger, so I would encourage you as we respond to this message, we're worshiping in a spirit of joy this morning, so let's sing. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night, and as dark shadows put to flight, rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice. Go into this week knowing that you are loved, remembering that we don't have church next Sunday. We have Christmas Eve service next week, Saturday at 6 p.m. up at Dalton campus. So we will see you there. Have a great week.